Welcome everybody to Church at Home and a happy Easter to you all. After so many weeks in Lent of working towards Jesus' crucifixion and watching him suffer as we went through Good Friday, it's absolutely lovely today to be able to say Christ is risen, alleluia, and to know him with us now by the power of that resurrection and alive forevermore. I hope you enjoyed Ian's opening slide. You see the power that moved the stone and that frightened the guard away, but more importantly, the life that came out of that tomb as death was put in its place and Jesus was raised from the dead. Absolutely wonderful. So we light our candle as we begin our time together. A reminder that Jesus is the light of the world and that death could not put that light out. So as we come together, we worship the risen Lord. Come, bring your strengths and your weaknesses.
We come with our confidence and our uncertainty.
Come, bring your laughter and your tears.
We come with our hopes and our disappointments.
The risen Christ calls us to worship him.
We come alone and together and meet him here.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
We begin our service today with a great favourite. Thine be the glory, risen, conquering Son. Bible reading today is from St. John's Gospel, one of Jesus's first appearances after he had risen from the dead, and Pauline's going to read it for us now.
Early on the first day of the week, While it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went towards the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed, for as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, 'I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God.'" Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her.
I'd like us today to pray in response to that Bible reading, and the words are going to come on the screen now. Please join in with the words in blue. Easter Jesus, risen and alive,
we praise you.
We praise you for your power over death.
We thank you for your patience with our hesitancy to believe.
We praise you for your words to Mary
and for your words to us. Thank you for knowing our need for reassurance.
We praise you for you know the reality of suffering.
And you have brought us a living hope at Easter and always. Thank you, risen Christ. Amen.
So, what images do you associate with Easter? Bunnies, spring flowers, newborn lambs, and most important, and probably the first thing you answered when I asked that question, would be eggs, particularly chocolate eggs, yes? They're a very common symbol of new life. And we see lots of them around us at this time of year, chocolate eggs particularly, but also not just big ones and little bigger ones than these and littler ones, but also ordinary eggs that people hide in places. People have egg hunts. Today I'm going to use these three Easter eggs and the passage from St. John's Gospel to help us understand a little bit more about what Easter and the resurrection can mean for us all. Okay, let's have a look at egg number one. Sparkly, shiny, looks attractive. Let's see what we've got inside. It says on the box, contains one Easter egg and one bag of chocolate buttons. I know straight away there's a problem with this one. I can just feel, look. Oh no, broken already. Must have got broken in transit. And no chocolate buttons. None in the box. That's not very good, is it? Worse still, the eggs, but the buttons have gone too. When Mary got to the tomb that morning, she was trying to hold it together. She wanted to care for Jesus' body, and yet she inside was shattered in pieces. The person they had lived with and loved, the person that they had found and followed, the person that they had learned with and laughed with, was gone, was dead. They thought he was going to solve all of their problems, the nation's problems, set them free from the oppression of the Roman rulers, and now they'd put him to death. Mary finds when she arrives at the tomb that the stone has been rolled away. For us, because we know the end of the story, that's great, but not for Mary. Not only is Jesus dead, but now somebody's stolen his body. Such disappointment and heartache, perhaps anger too. For many people this year, it's been the worst year for a very, very long time. Perhaps the worst year ever. Such expectations of ordinary life have been crushed, dashed, ruined, broken. Work. Perhaps people had a good job, COVID hit, they were then laid off and eventually have lost their jobs. Family, precious to us all. Maybe some of them have become ill, even died. And certainly we haven't seen enough of our families. Holidays. People planned, saved up for holidays in advance. Then they were cut off and some even didn't get proper refunds. Family celebrations that people have been looking forward to. We were looking forward to a wedding. And it was postponed once from June and again in September. We hope it's going to happen in August. But for over a year, everything has been cancelled. No big birthdays. We've tried to hold it together, haven't we? Kept strong, focused. But inside, do you feel a bit like you've been cracking up, falling to pieces? Maybe just in little ways and only quietly. But you know you just aren't quite your normal self. You feel like life is unravelling. And it's hard sometimes to keep up appearances, like the egg was very quick to know that was something wrong with this egg. At this low negative point, I'm going to play a slightly different Easter song for us, something that we came across this year that's not particularly new. I thought I wanted to use it on Good Friday, but actually it talks too much about Jesus being alive. But then for Easter Day, I felt it goes back over the events of Jesus's life. However, on reflection, I think it's really good for us today to just see how awful the death was that Jesus died. And I think it gives a very good visual representation of what Jesus's death would have been like. But also, it helps us know then what it was he came back to life from his resurrection. If you don't like very realistic or gory images, then please don't look. Perhaps just follow the words, or maybe just listen. But watch for when the tomb stone is rolled away and we see the grave clothes flatten as though the body has just come out, as though Jesus was resurrected at that moment. And then there isn't anything there, just the flattened gravestone clothes. And there's Jesus, who isn't the Jesus we've seen previously. He isn't quite the same person, but that's because it's a resurrected body. But it definitely is him. And Jesus, you can tell, Mary knows when he speaks her name. We're going to watch something, a version of Leonard Cohen's Hallelujah that's been rewritten for Easter, an Easter Hallelujah.
A crown of thorns placed on his head. He knew that he would soon be dead. He said, "Did you forget me, Father, did you?" They nailed him to a wooden cross. Soon all the world would feel the loss of Christ. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. He hung his head and prepared to die, then lifted his face up to the sky, said, I am coming home now, Father, to you. A reed which held his final sip was gently lifted to his lips. He drank his last and gave his soul to glory. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. The soldier who had used his sword to pierce the body of our Lord said, truly, this was Jesus Christ, our Savior. He looked with fear upon his son, then turned to face his Christ and Lord. Took from his head the thorny crown and wrapped him in a linen gown, then laid him down to rest inside the tomb. The holes in his hands, his feet, his side, now in our hearts we know he died to save us from ourselves. Days went by, again they came to move the stone, to bless the slain with oil and spice anointing. Hallelujah. But as they went to move the stone, they saw that they were not alone, for Jesus Christ has risen.
Egg number two. This one looks lovely. Pretty. Can't see the egg itself. It says one chocolate egg, including one chunky Kit Kat. For some reason or other, I've become rather, well, they're rather, I'm keen on those this year. If you're going to offer me some chocolate at the moment, that's what I fancy. So, good strong look, fancy box. Good strong egg. Yeah. It's not broken. Looks lovely, doesn't it? Oh, dropped it. I think it's all right. Let's have a look. Yep, it's fine still. In fact, it's completely whole. Isn't that great? Gosh, it's really hard. And empty. Where's my chunky Kit Kat, huh? That's what the disciples found. When they got to the tomb, they looked in and it was empty. No one there, just the empty grave clothes folded on the slab of stone. Nothing. The emptiness is awful. Where is he? They don't rush home. There's nothing to tell the rest of the disciples about, except Jesus' body has been stolen, even worse than they thought. Now they've got nothing to hold on to, no one to follow, no one to learn from. They probably felt quite abandoned, let down when he left them, but he said he'd be with them always. Where has he gone? Any of you who have lost a loved one knows that feeling of emptiness, the huge gaping hole, the gap that's in your life now that nothing and no one will ever fill. I wonder, do you ever feel empty, hollow, perhaps a sense of nothingness? Have you felt people have let you down, perhaps even God? You, like Mary, came to Jesus looking for him when you needed him and he wasn't there. For us all, it's really important to know that we need Christ, that we need salvation, to know that we aren't able to save ourselves, that we need to depend on him and not on other things or people. Sometimes we have to have those things knocked away so that we can put, well, so that we can't put our faith in them, that we can't put our faith in anyone else but God. So sometimes emptiness isn't always such a bad thing. So on to egg number three. Looking good, sparkly, looks interesting, should be okay. Let's open the box. Of course, it's the same as the other one. Feels heavy. That doesn't feel cracked. Yep. Beautiful. And it's full. Not only is it not cracked, it has also got, and look what I found in it, the buttons and the chunky Kit Kat. You didn't expect that, did you? Or perhaps you did. Depends how often you've seen me talk. The disciples thought they had found the tomb empty, but actually it was full of light and life and hope. Death has been beaten and there was no dead body. The darkness was wiped out. Dazzling angels, resurrected power had dispelled it. A bit like the short opening slide video that Ian had done for us. The past dealt with, sins forgiven, the present healed, freedom from captivity, and a future hope, all to come, all in the empty tomb. Do you see, it was meant to be empty. That wasn't the problem, that was the solution. Because the tomb was empty, that meant the miracle had happened, and life will be full, abundantly full, with the risen Christ. More than we even expect, more satisfying, more fulfilling than anything else, even more so than chocolate. Jesus said, I have come that you might have life and have it in it all its fullness, that you might have abundant life. And this is what the emptiness means. When we are empty, then God can fill us. When we're so full of ourselves, that's an expression, isn't it? But when we are so full of ourselves, we think we don't need God, we don't have time for him. But when we are empty, God then comes and fills us. I'm going to play you a modern Easter song now, See What a Morning. And it, for me, it really expresses the message of Easter, the miracle of Easter. And it's quite suited particularly to our story from St. John's Gospel from Mary's perspective. I love the lines, death is dead, love has won, Christ has conquered. I hope you enjoy it. See What a Morning.
See what a morning. See. she turns from the empty tomb, hears a voice speaking, calling her name. It's the Master, the Lord, raised to life again. The voice that spans the years, speaking life, stirring hope, bringing peace to us, will sound till he appears. For he lives, Christ is risen. Spirit who clothes faith with certainty, honor and blessing, glory and praise to the King, crowned with power and authority. And we are raised with him. Death is dead, love is won, Christ is conquered.
Song. I hope you enjoyed it. I did. It is possible with faith in Jesus Christ to face disappointment, abandonment, emptiness, loss and grief, uncertainty, despair. God takes them and turns death into life, despair into hope, a desperate situation into a wonderful opportunity. Heartache can become joy. Doubt become faith. Emptiness becomes fullness, all because of the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Mary encountered the risen Christ at her deepest point of need. And when she hears his voice speaking her name, everything changes. The amazing power of God has done the unthinkable, the unimaginable, the unexpected, the impossible. Jesus is alive. Mary's trust and faith are renewed, and life didn't just flow out of the tomb, out of Jesus, but into Mary, into her and everyone else who came in contact with him and with the disciples. Every one of us, if we come and bring our emptiness of God to God, can be filled. Easter is a wonderful day to renew your trust and faith in God, or even to take a step for the first time. We invite the life of Jesus to come into us and to be alive in us. Do you feel broken in pieces? Do you feel empty, hollow, perhaps apparently holding things together? Maybe there's just nothing inside. Or do you want to know that you can be full of life, full of Jesus, full of hope, faith? That's the difference between Christianity and all other faiths. Jesus doesn't just set a standard that we're to live up to, or even a model his life to copy, or commandments to obey. He comes, gives his life for us, instead of us dying. And then he comes back to life, and he comes and lives in us to be Christ in us. A new life begins. I'd really like us to respond to this offer of life that Jesus gives this Easter. Whoever you are, whether you're old or young, whether you've been going to church for a long time, many years, or whether you've just begun watching church at home, we can all come to Jesus. So I'd like us to pray together, and a prayer will come on the screen now.
I come to you, risen Christ, because I recognize I am often empty. All I trust slips through my fingers, and sadness and grief at my loss is deep. Call me by name as you called Mary. Help me to have eyes to recognize you and a heart to welcome you. I praise and thank you for dying on the cross for me. Come and live in me in your resurrection power today and always. Amen.
Ian chose the next song, and it fits in really well here. It's called This Is My Resurrection Day by Rend Collective, who, just by as it happens, are coming to the O2 Arena in Newcastle, October the 21st. We've got tickets. We had them for last year, and it's been obviously stopped, but why not come? You can also have tickets too. But This Is My Resurrection Day. Nothing's going to hold me down. Talks about not being held down, and about really living with the power of the resurrection. And when we've sung this, then Paul is going to lead our prayers.
You're living, I'm alive. Because your cross is powerful, because you rose invincible, I can get up off the floor. This is my resurrection day. Nothing's gonna hold me in the grave. This is my resurrection day. Nothing's gonna hold me down.
Father, it's Easter, a time to remember, a time to celebrate, and a time to thank you with all our hearts, to remember Jesus's ministry, his suffering and death upon the cross to save us from ourselves and bring us forgiveness for our selfishness, conceit, deceit, and all our sinful ways, to celebrate his resurrection, his continual presence with us, to help guide us, together with the Holy Spirit, towards a life lived with you. We do not just remember Jesus, we know him. He is here with us now and every day. Thank you, Lord, that you love us so much that you gave him to us. Sadly, more and more people seem to ignore you or reject you, or some either don't know of you or don't want to know about you. Father, we pray that you touch the hearts of all people who, for whatever reason, do not know you as we do. Open their minds to ask about you and Jesus. Remove the cynicism with which the world now views you, so that more and more may come to know your love, know the true meaning of Easter. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, thanks to your world's brilliant scientists, we now have the means to protect us against COVID. We pray that you influence world leaders, policymakers, and those responsible for the rollout of the various vaccines to avoid selfishness and nationalism. We pray that all the agencies involved act generously and cooperatively in the spirit of love and reconciliation, not only to bring control throughout the world of this dreadful pandemic, but going forward to learn that acting with love and cooperation will bring about a more peaceful and joyous coexistence for all the peoples of the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all those who are suffering sickness, poverty, or oppression, for all those who have died or have lost loved ones, especially those known personally to us. Father, we pray that you will bring relief to all of those suffering, comfort them, and let them know of your undying love for them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we pray for our local community and our church. We pray for those living in Ina Street, Mary Street, Edith Street, and those running the dancer studio, when or if it opens again. We pray for Joanna, our priest, the PCC and the LMPDT, and all the work and plans that are being undertaken in our parish. Thank you, Father, for hearing our prayers. May your kingdom come and your will be done through us. Amen.
To finish our time together, I'm going to show you a short video that I bought a few years ago and have never used. And today is just the right day. We've had a bit of fun with chocolate eggs, and this man talks about life and death and resurrection, and he talks about eggs. So I hope you appreciate this.
Consider the egg. This Easter delight, its chocolatey shell, its sugary white, its soft golden centre, so gooey, so sweet. Now consider this thought. This mass-produced treat that we bite or we lick or force whole through our jaws is a symbol of life. So next time you eat yours, remember, you came from a single egg cell. You start as an egg. Do you end as a shell? See, the egg asks a question that leaves us perplexed. You live and you die, but then what happens next? What happens next when you breathe your last breath? Is there heaven or hell? Is there life after death? When you bury your loved ones and say your goodbyes, is there reason to hope that one day they might rise? As you stroll through the graves, past the flowers and weeds, Are you walking on eggshells or walking on seeds? To answer the egg, let me tell you a story of brokenness, suffering, death, hope and glory. The story of Jesus, who walked on this earth for 33 years, give or take, from his birth to his death, after trial and unjust conviction. He died in disgrace through cruel crucifixion. They took down his body, his now shattered shell, and laid it to rest in a stony cold cell. So far, so normal. Just one more egg, broken. But what of the words this preacher had spoken? He'd said he would die, just like me and like you. But his what happens next seemed too good to be true. He'd said he'd return, come alive from the grave. He said he would conquer, said he would save. So how should we sum up that scene in the tomb? A shell in a cell, or an egg in a womb? At sunrise on Sunday, the world got its answer. A hope that transcends every stroke, every cancer, all suffering, sickness, sorrow and fear, that holds every hand and that wipes every tear. Because death could not bind him, he smashed his way through. From that cell, from that shell, there exploded a new life everlasting, and physical proof that he is the way and the life and the truth. Because Jesus died and because Jesus rose, he, more than anyone anywhere, knows that death isn't final, that death can be cheated for once and for all, because he defeated the spectre that hangs over you, over me. He died and he rose so that we could go free. So consider the egg. This Easter confection speaks hope, offers life, proclaims resurrection.
Many thanks to Pauline, Paul, and Ian. And a final blessing before our final hymn, which is today, Jesus Christ is Risen Today, a great way to go out. So a final blessing. May God the Father bless us with thankfulness and joy this Easter. May the Holy Spirit bless us with the gift of wonder and wisdom and faith. And may the Lord Jesus, our Saviour Jesus, our risen Christ, bless us with reassurance, hope, and his resurrected presence this Easter and always. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you always. Amen.